So, our last session, Human Development in Indonesia. I'm thrilled to see we have almost no attrition. The hardy, the many, the committed, still out there. And I will follow the other moderators in not reading the bios because then our time would be up from the start. Just to note that we have a good friend and colleague from downriver a little bit, Haiti, and then from the heartland. And we'll just go in the order that we're listed in the program. And then after this panel...
Actually, I went to Yale. So it's not so much the heart shape as the difference between Yale and Harvard.
Oh, that nice school down in Connecticut somewhere, yeah, we've heard of it. And then after a panel, just a few closing remarks before the conference is over. So without further ado, the floor is yours, Ben.
Great. Okay, well, thank you very much. So the title of this talk is Using Evidence to Improve Social Protection Programs in Indonesia. And what I wanted to do with my, I guess, 20 minutes is to give you some examples of some of the kinds of work that I've been doing in Indonesia over the past, I guess it's over the past 8 years or so, trying to work with the government of Indonesia to improve kind of their social protection policies. So I should start by saying, I guess Gus asked, you know, who are the young people under 60 working in Indonesia? I'm at least one of them. And this is joint with many people, including Professor Rima Hanna, who's another one, who's at the Kennedy School, who I encourage you all to get to know, and many of our other colleagues as well, Vivi Alatas from the World Bank, Julia Tobias, Abhijit Banerjee from my colleague at MIT, Jordan Kyle and Sudarno Sumarto, who's with Tante Dota in the government. So this is joint. I'm drawing from a bunch of different papers with many people, and I want to acknowledge kind of all of their contributions as well. So, click. Okay. So, just the background here is that if you compare the way Indonesia is approaching social protection policy now with what it was doing, say, 20 years ago, first of all, they're doing more, I think. But second of all, they've been moving away from non-targeted subsidies, like subsidized fuel, subsidized electricity, subsidized food to some degree, towards targeted transfer programs. Okay, and that's been, I think, the big switch in policy. And that sort of, I guess, began in some level, starting with the economic crisis, and it's been continued sort of today. And there are many, many examples of these kinds of policies. So there's the Raskin program, which provides subsidized rights for the poor. There are scholarships. There's health insurance for the poor. There's a conditional cash transfer program called PKH. There have been unconditional cash transfer programs at a bunch of times, you know, BLT, BLSM, et cetera. So there have been a bunch of these programs that all have the feature that they are targeted explicitly towards poor households. Now the problem is that, you know, the government faces a bunch of challenges with these programs, right? The first problem is if we now want to target the poor households, the government has to figure out who's poor, right? And it turns out that's actually really tricky, right? You know, in the U.S., you know, the government observes everyone's tax returns. Everyone files taxes. We observe their tax returns. If your tax return is under a certain number, then we know you're poor. And that has issues, right? Maybe you don't work as hard because you're worried about income taxes, whatever. But at least the government knows who's not earning very much. But in a place like Indonesia, where you have some large fraction of the population either in agriculture or in the informal economy, they're not there yet, right? And so they have to do something else to figure out who's poor. And that's a challenge. And the government, I think, has really embraced that challenge and has been working over the past decade. I mean, it's been working on this ever since they started with targeted transfer programs, but have been working over the past, you know, 6, 7, 8 years in particular towards creating what they call a unified database of poor households that are going to be used as the basis for targeting all of these programs. But, you know, who should be in that unified database? And how do we figure out who's poor and kind of what are the trade-offs and challenges the government should face? You know, second problem is, even if we know who's poor, actually implementing these programs, actually making sure the people who are on the list get the benefits and the people who are not on the list don't get the benefits, and that all the benefits that the government thinks are getting handed out actually get received by the people who are supposed to get them is also tricky. And so even conditional targeting, how do you implement these programs effectively? So these are, I think, two serious programs that I think the government is very very much aware of and very much trying to work to improve. And so the work that I've been doing on these issues has been working very closely with the government to use randomized trials to answer these questions. So I'll give you some examples of what we mean. And I should say, by the way, that one of my many hats is I'm co-director of the Teach Jamil Poverty Action Lab at MIT, which works on randomized trials kind of throughout the world. And actually, our experience is that Indonesia has been among the most receptive governments in the world towards really embracing this kind of evidence-based approach towards improving policy. So it's actually a real success story, and I'll kind of give you a couple of examples that I've been kind of closely involved with. Okay, so let's talk about targeting. So, you know, as I mentioned, targeting, you know, the government doesn't observe stuff, so targeting developing countries like Indonesia involves a different set of challenges, and there's basically three main approaches that governments can use. Okay, one is called a proxy means test. So, you know, in the US, we observe your income, we test if you're below a threshold, you get the program, that's called a means test. If we don't observe your income, maybe we observe a proxy for your income, then we do a proxy means test. So that basically means the government comes to your house, they collect data on, you know, 45 features, like what kind of floor you have, and what kind of house, you know, roof you have, and how many people live there, and some stuff that basically, imagine if, you know, someone from, or actually it's from BPS, the government statistics office, someone from BPS is sitting at your front door, kind of looking around, like what can they see? Right? And the idea is that that's stuff that's pretty hard for you to lie about, that is predictive of your income. Okay, so they write down the 47 things, like yes, they have a dirt floor, but they have a tile roof or whatever, and that gets entered in the database, and the government predicts, based on all that information, who they think is most likely to be poor and who's not. That's one method. A second method is community-based targeting, and that basically, the idea there is the central government says, forget about it, there's no hope of us in Jakarta knowing who in some village or some kelurahan somewhere is actually poor. So you guys just come up with a list of the poor people and you tell us. Okay, that's the second approach. There's varieties on that, but that's the basic idea. Or maybe you say, well, the government's going to say, you know, these people are poor, but then we're going to let the community have some discretion to make some changes to the list if they sort of feel like the government didn't get it quite right. So, but basically allowing the community to make some choices. And the third approach is self-selection. And here the idea is you want to say, look, rather than sort of some enumerator from BPS showing up at your house and deciding whether you're poor or not, to allow people to make people apply for a program first, and then if they apply, do a proxy means test. And the idea is that maybe only the people who think they're going to pass, who kind of know they're poor, are going to apply, and the rich will self-select themselves out. Okay? So that's the idea. And so what we're going to do in these papers is we're going to, you know, working with many different kind of variety of actors in the Indonesian government, with Tempe Duaka, with Bappenas, with BPS, we conducted a series of randomized trials where we actually tried these different methods. You know, the government said, here are some villages that you want, or in Kelurahan that you should try these methods in. We're, you know, rolling out a new program or whatever. You know, we don't know which is going to work better, so we randomly allocate some Kelurahans to some method and some to a different method, and we compare to sort of see which was actually most effective in finding the poor. So this, I'm going to tell you about two projects. One was sort of comparing the PMT in a community, and the other was about the automatic proxy means test where they kind of come to your house versus the self-selection one where you have to apply first, and sort of we're going to show you some results. Okay, and the key idea of using a randomized trial is that I think actually in the previous presentation from Lamprecci, you saw an example with sort of the double or nothing was another example. The key is that with a randomized trial, because there's no difference between which area got, you know, the PMT, which got the community, except the results of a lottery, so we randomized them by lottery, it's really easy to figure out the impact. You just compare across them. Okay? Now you may ask the question, how do we know, right, who's poor? The whole poor premise was we don't know who's poor. And the answer is, in this context, before we start, we do a baseline survey. We're basically working with an independent survey organization. They come in, it's nothing to do with targeting. They interview the households first. That's kind of our benchmark of what people's actual income or consumption is. And then we do these methods and sort of see which of these methods kind of best matches who's actually poor. Okay, so here's some results. So the first project was one we did in 640 locations. These were like, not even whole desas or kelurahans. They were like, you know, airway level or airway level in some cases, really big. And we compared a PMT method where the government chose 49 indicators, the standard ones they were using, and they came to people's houses and sort of said, well, you know, check them, and they ran the regression and they came up with a list. And the other method we tried was a community method. And here, the way this worked was, you know, they had a meeting kind of at the local level. They had a facilitator who came and said, you know, what we're gonna do is we wanna help. We invited everyone in the community to the meeting. And they said, well, let's see if we can figure out who, you know, try to rank everyone from, you know, the best well-off to the least well-off, from Pali Miskin to Pali Mampu. And literally, they had index cards, right? And they put everyone's name on an index card, and they said, okay, well, we're gonna start with, you know, Ben and Jay, and who do you think's better off? And they were having a discussion. Well, first they started by thinking, what do we mean by better off in our community? And so they brainstormed a list, and those were all the things they meant by better off in the community. They wrote up a list on the board. And then they started comparing, okay? And I should say, we had no idea if this was actually gonna work, right? Or whether it was gonna be the people who got listed as kind of very, very poor were the ones who were actually gonna be kind of the nephews of the village head or whatever, or actually we're gonna get really good information. We didn't know what was gonna happen. But in the end, actually, they were able to do this pretty well. We ended up with kind of a full complete rank ordering of everyone in the ERTE, and then they said, okay, we know how many rough people we're gonna pick. We just picked the same numbers we would have picked in the PMT, but just the bottom chunk from that list. Okay, and so this was an RCT, so we can say, well, what happened? Which worked better? So this shows you the distribution of per capita consumption from our baseline survey. The green is the people that were chosen by the proxy means test, and this line are the people that were chosen by the community method. Okay, so what can you see here is that actually, okay, the regression-based approach, the asset-based approach, did do better right around the cutoff. Okay, this is like PPP $2 a day, this is PPP $1 a day. So this is like this is kind of roughly the poverty line, this is kind of the very, very poor poverty line. So it was the case that the objective approach did better at sort of identifying people who were just below the poverty line. That's why you see there's more people in the green bin right over here. And over here, the community approach picked people who, you know, had a little people who were kind of just above the poverty line. On the other hand, at the very, very, very poor, actually this method, the community method, found more of the very, very poor. So it's kind of a mix. Basically, right around the threshold, the kind of data approach did a bit better. On the other hand, though, if you went and asked people in the village, well, here's the list of people that were identified. Do you think it's a good list, bad list? Would you make any changes to this list? People vastly preferred the community list. So if I said, you know, here's the list of people that were picked, who do you think should be removed from this list? Or who do you think should be added to this list? Right? In the community treatment, they made about one-third fewer changes to the list than they did in the kind of government-based list. We had an anonymous comment box. Put in complaints if you have, give us complaints if you have problems. There were about 65% fewer complaints in the community treatments than in the top-down treatment.
Sorry, do they know which ones are which?
No. We just said here are the people who were chosen. No, they only know the method that they did in their village. We know they don't know they're part of an experiment. They just know in our village they did this method, and here's what happened. And people liked it a lot more. And I'm not going to go into the details now, but if you look at the reason why, it turns out that that in the community method, even though it was worse on consumption, we also asked people in their baseline survey how they self-identified. So on a scale of 1 to 6, where, you know, the poorest are on ladder 1 and the richest are on ladder 6, kind of where do you put yourself? Say, oh, I'm a 3, I'm a 6, whatever. The community method did a much better job picking other people who were like 1s. So the people who really identified themselves as poor, when the community held their meeting, they made sure those people were getting on the list. And so I think partially what may be happening here is there's a bit of a tension between how we define poverty based on kind of per capita consumption, which is how they usually define it when they do, like, you know, poverty in the Susanos or the official poverty rate, and how people are actually perceiving poverty locally. And when you ask the community, they pick the poor people who they perceive as poor locally, and they like that list a lot better. And when you use the data approach, you kind of get what the data wants. And so actually, there's not, I think, the end, this says there's not an obvious right or wrong answer. And actually, there also wasn't a big problem of kind of elites putting their friends or uncles or whatever. That wasn't an issue. So really it comes down to a trade-off of what does the country want? Like, do they want to use kind of the, maximize kind of the poverty headcount as defined by, you know, the national poverty rate? If you want to do that, you should use the data approach. But if you want to sort of target your aid to the people who sort of locally people feel needed the most, you should use a more community approach, and you'll end up with kind of a lot more satisfaction and legitimacy, perhaps, of the list. So that's one experiment we did. Another thing which the government is really thinking very hard about is, should they allow on-demand application, right? So one big problem with this PMT list is you have to go every 3 years and do a census of the entire country, basically. It's very expensive. Our former Minister of Finance is nodding his head. Yes, very expensive. And so the question is, should you do that, or should you, you know, have people apply when they feel like they want the benefits? And again, there's a trade-off. Like, if you have people apply, maybe only the people that really think they're poor or really in the program are going to stand in line and pay, you know, go to the big hassle, you have to go, get interviewed, whatever. Maybe only they will do it. Or on the other hand, maybe the poor are so marginalized they don't really feel comfortable going to a government office, and they're not going to do it. And so we don't really know kind of which is going to be more effective. So again, this was something that we did. We worked very closely with the PEKAHA program. This was aimed at the very, very poor. They were expanding PEKAHA in three provinces, in Central Java, in Lampung, and in South Sumatra. And they said, look, we're expanding to these new locations, to 400 new Desa Kelurahan. Why don't you randomize? In 200 of them, you'll use the self-targeting approach, and two of them, you use the regular PMT approach, and we'll see which one does a better job finding the poor. Okay, and so you first, if you want to find the poor, you have to, if you want to do self-targeting, you have to explain what the program is, so people know what they're applying for, right? So we did that, and then they came and they applied. They wait around in line, so if you know you're not going to get this program, you don't want to wait in this long line. That's kind of not very fun. Then you get interviewed, and then if it looks based on your interview response that you're likely to pass the test, then they come to your house and verify you. Okay? And the answer, so for those of you who know how to read a CDF, this basically means that this is the self-targeting, and this is the automatic, this is self-on-application, this is the non-application. The people who applied in self-targeting were much, much poorer than the ones who got the program in self-targeting were much poorer than the ones who got the program in general. And this shows you the probability that you get the program. And actually, the self-targeting actually had a higher probability of getting the program for the very poor. And I think the reason is that the government enumerators, they do their best, but they don't necessarily know where all the very, very poor are living, right? If they're living kind of in these really marginalized areas, they might not even get surveyed. They might try to survey everybody, but they might miss some people. And missing people in a census is a common issue everywhere. The US has this problem. But in the on-demand application, they could come and apply themselves instead of saying, hello, I'm here, like I need this program. And they actually did better at getting the very poor. And then for the rich, there was or the middle class or whatever, people who were not supposed to get the program, in the automatic enrollment, there was a small number of people who kind of fell through the cracks and got the program anyway. But when you had to apply first, those people didn't even bother to apply. So almost none of them got it in the on-demand program because they didn't even bother to try. Right? Because they said, I'm not going to get it, so why bother? And so kind of the lesson I should say from both these projects is, you know, first of all, I think that the first one sort of said, look, we should be more open to kind of a community-based approach. And I think that some of the new procedures that they're using in terms of modifying the unified database allow community input exactly for this reason, that there are people know are really poor who are excluded. They allow kind of community modifications. I think the government is now really thinking very hard about whether this on-demand approach could make sense for sort of the future of the program. A third example I want to give you, I'm just going to give you a flavor of this, is a project on that we did on transparency. And so here, this happened about, I don't know, 3 or 4 years ago. 3 years ago, I guess the government was considering hand sending out ID cards for the Raskin program, so for all the beneficiaries. And before, they were thinking about mailing out all these ID cards, before they did, actually, you know, the government, I think it was actually Budiono, who was the vice president, who said, you know, actually, before we go send out 15 million of these cards, I would like to know if this is a good idea. And B, I would like to know if this is going to create all kinds of problems, because people are going to, you know, people sort of say, well, gee, like someone, so-and-so, Erasmus is very complicated, people are getting it, not getting it, and all of a sudden the government sends all these cards, what's going to happen? So we worked very closely with the government, with Tampei Duaka, to do, and various other government institutions, to develop a study beforehand on sort of a pilot basis to sort of see what would happen. So we mailed out these Raskin, the government mailed out these Raskin ID cards in 6 kabupatens, in 378 desa kelurahan, randomly chosen out of 600, and the other ones didn't get the ID cards, and they went into survey and sort of saw what happened. And the answer is that they made a huge difference. So the places that we mailed the cards, so this is the total amount, got about 1.25 kilos. The eligible households in places that we mailed out the cards got about 1.2 kilos more rice than the people in the villages we didn't mail out the cards, on a base of about 5, so about 25% more. And not all our cards even got out there. Only about a third of our cards actually got received. But even so, being in a village where we mailed out the cards increased the amount the eligible households got by like 20-something percent. The ineligible got nothing, got no less. So this sort of like all of a sudden more rice was getting out just because people had this ability to bargain. And so that was an example where actually, you know, that was one of many data points, not that we can should claim credit for the entire program, but that was one of many data points that sort of said, look, actually it looks like this is gonna be a good idea. And then the government went ahead and sort of mailed out the cards to everybody. And now, of course, there's a zillion cards, card through this, card through that. There are many cards. So, you know, what I wanted to conclude by saying is, you know, this is an example where I think of the kind of rigorous microevidence that we can now start to bring to bear on some of these policy questions. You know, the government in Indonesia, I think, has been remarkably open to this kind of evidence, not just in this space, but in other spaces, like in Take the Hot program, the Generosity program, in education. And I think this kind of rigorous evidence base can sort of really be important for doing good policy. I should say, you know, we're also, as a little bit of advertisement, we now have an office at working very closely with LPAMUI. We have a JPAL office, Poverty Action Lab office in Jakarta, sort of doing this stuff. So if people are interested in working with us, you should, you know, look up our website. And then I'll circulate a link later of a little video from Tampei Duaka, which shows kind of some of the policies actually being put into place, and you can sort of see how some of these policy ideas that we talked about in these experiments made their way into policy.
Thank you.
So, another aspect of human development is financial inclusion in Indonesia. Include me. Unambiguous. So, the roadmap of the presentation, I'd like to do 4 things in the next 20 minutes. What is financial inclusion and why should we care about it? Why should you sit through this presentation? What innovations have been made in microfinance over the last 3 decades in general and in Indonesia specifically, since Indonesia has been one of the global leaders in sustainable microfinance? What are current constraints to developing microfinance further in the future? And what are some specific proposals for creating a more enabling policy environment in Indonesia to improve financial inclusion? So what is it? Ensuring access to formal financial services for everyone, not just those at the top of a nation's economic pyramid. And we're talking especially about those who are often excluded, which are low-income households and family businesses. I call these the unbanked majority or underbanked majority because they're most of society in developing the transitional economies. Majority of households do not have access to formal financial services. But it's not just low-income countries or emerging economies, but there's also a significant subset of the market in high-income countries. And in the United States, for example, it's mainly immigrants and economically marginalized communities. That's what financial inclusion is. Why does it matter? Financial inclusion, I think, provides those with the greatest potential to gain from economic development the financial tools necessary to realize these benefits. And so we have in many countries, Indonesia's included, rapid economic growth, but at the same time increasing inequality. So how does this happen? The economy is growing, either in aggregate or per capita, but the Gini coefficient, for example, a measure of inequality, is growing at the same time. Or in Indonesia, if you look at any metric of inequality, Java, off Java, gender. So if you look at location, you look at gender, you look at the macro Gini coefficient, all of them are getting worse, even with all the redistribution programs. And what we mean by financial inclusion is really trying to provide the same services that we all need in conventional markets, but tailored to the very specific conditions of the working poor and those at the bottom of the economic pyramid, the poorest of the poor. In a moment, I'll tell you what the services are and what some of the innovations are in providing the services. But when I say tailoring or adapting these conventional tools, we mean changing the design of your product, the pricing of the product, delivery systems to the needs of this demographic. We also need, in addition to the product, pricing, delivery systems, institutional innovation. How do you develop an institution that can get the right product to the right people at the right time, the right price, so that it's financially viable? And the most important reason that we should be thinking about financial inclusion, I think it's an essential component for a nation to try to achieve inclusive development, because basically inclusive development requires equality of economic opportunity. Several of our speakers talked about having the capabilities, the skills, the education, and so on, but you also need access to financial services to be able to capitalize on your skills and economic opportunity. I think Umari also mentioned financing as a major constraint. I think it was one of the seven that you would put up. So some of the innovations in microfinance. We'll get the good news first, in general. I'll give you an example from Indonesia, and then what we will nicely call the challenges, or not nicely call how Indonesia is actually going backwards. So over the past 30 years, we have developed a variety of successful institutional models for the sustainable delivery of microfinance services to low-income households and family businesses. My focus has been on nationwide sustainable models. You have other complementary models for especially marginalized groups that are important, but I've been focusing on the big systems. Most of the models that have been developed exist in Indonesia. There are specialized strategic business units within general commercial banks, and the example I will give in a moment is BRI, Bankara Indonesia. There are also village banks, and in Indonesia, there are BKD, there are over 5,000 of them in Java. Community banks, BPR. Membership-based organizations, KUD, co-ops, credit unions, and the like. They all exist in Indonesia. And Indonesia is also moving to bank service agency models, or banks working with telecommunication companies for mobile banking. You see all of this going on in Indonesia, and it's quite encouraging. Specific example, BRI, Bankrat Indonesia. This is probably the biggest, most successful, totally unsubsidized microbanking program in the world, and nobody knows about it, including several of our friends at BI, I'm sad to say. That's not an accident, because sometimes too much knowledge for regulators leads to unproductive desires to interfere with operations. Just leave it at that. World's largest, most profitable microbanking operation. It was commercialized in the mid-1980s, 30 years ago. Still growing, still evolving. It's inspired other Indonesian commercial banks like Danamon and BTPN to try to enter the market, to try to replicate or adapt BRI's model. And Indonesia also has the first for-profit apex microbank, Bank Andara, which is basically a bank for microbanks or a bank for microfinance institutions. It wholesales to the retail distributors. A few numbers about BRI. Is Bunisa out here somewhere? Okay, we're very fortunate to have the head of BRI's New York agency here. So if you have any further questions, the expert is sitting in the back. Okay. In 2014, so end of last year, BRI was Indonesia's largest bank in terms of total assets, total profits, and total retail distribution network. So BRI microbanking within that was one-third of the total value of BRI loans outstanding. And these are small loans, $1,000 to $2,000 loans in a very big bank. So it's not number of loans, it's value that was one-third, which is remarkable. And I don't know if it's kind of a well-kept secret, BRI was the most profitable bank, but three-quarters of the profits came from microbanking. Small loans, high quality means profits, good return. And these services were provided by a network of over 9,000 BRI units, something they call TRAS, TRAS Mobile, cash offices. Now some of the best borrowers in remote areas are also agents, and e-channels. And BRI will soon be the first private bank in the world to have its own satellite. Pretty remarkable. Figures at the end of 2014, loans outstanding over 12 billion US dollars. That's not milyar rupiah. Yeah, that's dollars. So add a lot of zeros or take them away, whichever you like to do. Over 7 million borrowers. Quality of the loan portfolio, very high at just over 1% non-performing loans. And the data is real. BRI has a system of rules-based aging of arrears and automatic write-off. There's no discretion for the loan officers at this level. So the data, I think, is quite reliable. Even better on micro savings, total savings over 13 billion US dollars. Small accounts, you're talking about hundreds of dollars, not tens of thousands of dollars. 37.5 million savings accounts. So you can do the math, you can see the average savings account or the average loan are relatively small. That was a specific example from Indonesia. But in general, why has an institution like BRI been so successful? It's by adapting to evolving markets and evolving demand. I'm going to list the services and some of the innovations in order of demand. So, contrary to popular belief, the number one service demanded by low-income households is not credit. It's payment services, transfer and payment services, moving money from the village to the city, maybe to support your child while they're in school, then hopefully they get a really good job and they send money back to the parents who supported them during their schooling. Money from rural areas to the cities, cities back to rural areas. For overseas workers, from abroad, not to Indonesia, but to your home village. Very important. Bill and payment services, transfers, and the reason this is so important to a low-income household, if you can reduce the transaction costs, reduce the risk, improve the efficiency, you're increasing disposable income because they're spending less on financial services. Savings is the second most demanded service. And it goes from giro, or demand deposits, passbook savings, tabangan, simpanan, time deposits, deposito, and something called commitment savings, which means you're saving for a specific purpose like school fees or the Philippines Christmas, something like that. And it helps with income smoothing. It's a cushion for shocks. It's often part of your retirement, and it's a way to accumulate assets and wealth. It can be invested in household improvement or in business opportunities. credit, the third most in demand. It could be either working capital, mainly for existing businesses, or some small investment. And in a small business, investment and working capital looks pretty much the same. You buy a sewing machine, it generates income from day one. So it's not what you would think of as a normal big investment. The lesson from that is you don't need differential loan rates or different products. You don't have arbitrage between the two products. Increases income and wealth if the business does well and ultimately tries to improve quality of life. Fourth type of service are services to mitigate risks that we all face, whether we're rich or poor. So loan insurance, life insurance, health insurance, weather index crop insurance, all designed to try to increase vulnerability to common risks. Innovation in products, innovation in delivery systems. Sometimes all the way down to the village level in Indonesia, there's a very old program that was the model for the BRI program called BKK, Badantara Kecamatan, Jawa Tengah, under the Central Java Bank Bank. Central Government Reserve Development Bank. Yeah, okay. We have a long history with that, don't we? Yeah, so that's another story. Now increasingly providing services directly to the client via mobile phones, especially transfer payments, payment services. And we've had innovation in regulation and supervision. And often the regulation for microbanking is simply recalibrated. You have exactly the same risk as you have with big loans. Credit risk, risk that people won't repay it. Liquidity risk, treasury management problems. But often you have to change the way you measure these risks, the way you measure efficiency, the way you measure adequate liquidity and so on. So it's the same risks, but measured differently. And often it's even stricter. If you have a very small banking unit very far from a major banking operation, you might require actually more liquidity rather than less liquidity to be safe. And sometimes you have delegated supervision. In the case of Indonesia, for example, BRI has been delegated to supervise these village banks, BPDs, on behalf of the central bank, because there are just too many of them. Central bank wants to focus its supervision on the bigger banks, the banks that might cause systemic risk. When you have thousands of these little village banks around, and they don't compete with BRI because they're at a lower income level, these tend to be hundreds of dollars for 3 months with weekly repayments rather than thousands of dollars for 1.5 to 2 years with monthly repayments. Different markets, market segmentation. So it makes sense for having a bank like BRI to provide technical support and supervision to the BPDs, the village banks. That's the good news. So we've got a couple of minutes for some concerns. We've applied theory to practice, and we know basically what works for effective microfinance. But Indonesia still has considerable unmet effective demand, and any kind of indicator that looks at financial depth, Indonesia is very much underbanked. So, for example, BRI did a survey a few years ago, impact of the programs to date and future market potential. And the good news and the bad news about the future potential, the good news is that of the people who have access to formal financial services at the bottom, BRI dominates. Better news is a lot of people out there don't seem to have the services yet. It's a great market opportunity for BRI and its competitors. At the end, I'll give you some references if you want to get the data on banking coverage or coverage of financial services in Indonesia and other countries. There's still some problems with product design and delivery systems, especially agriculture credit. There's still some prudential and non-prudential regulatory barriers. One example, if you have unconventional collateral, movable asset rather than land and buildings, or you have a group guarantee, regulators sometimes consider that unsecured, that means you have to have 100% risk weight, that means capital that's set aside. All that means is that it's much more expensive for the bank to make the loan. It's a disincentive to serve the market. Failure of competition. This is probably the biggest problem in Indonesia right now. So after the East Asian crisis in the late 90s, World Bank, Asian Development Bank went around and they said the problem is you have to consolidate your banking system because the only sound bank is a big bank. Now we know math and we know that health is ratios, size should not matter. And so what you have is consolidation and homogenization of the banking sector. So in Indonesia, fewer banks and the banks all are starting to look alike. Same products, same prices, in the same markets. And at the top, there's an oligopoly. It's a club, it's a cartel. So most of the assets, most of the market is controlled by a handful of banks. It's not so different from other countries we know, but it is true in Indonesia. And it's actually kind of great to own a bank now in Indonesia. There are no new banking licenses being issued. And you can't fail. So think about that. Barriers to entry. You can't get in and you can die. I wish I had a bank right now in Indonesia. And you have really nice cooperation at the top between banks to set prices. What this does is it really kills innovation and it's actually decreased access to financial services. The regulators love it because all the banks look the same. They're easy to regulate. But in terms of providing access to a very diverse market, it's not such a good idea. And with that, Indonesia, from very successful deregulation, is going back into financial repression. What does that mean? It says, I'm going to tell a bank who to lend to at what price. KUR is probably the biggest program. You can get lots of data about disbursement and almost nothing about repayment. And you're measured by how much money you disperse, not how much you collect. Sorry, this was SBY's favorite program. It undercut all the market-based successful microbanking programs in Indonesia, including BRI. So, creating a more enabling policy environment is the major recommendation. And we want smart regulation to avoid unintended consequences. So, we don't want over-exuberant deregulation, which was one of the problems with the East Asian financial crisis when you had deregulation and liberalization without the supervisory capacity to oversee the rapid expansion of the banking system in Indonesia, and so banks took excessive risk with depositors' money. Not good. So you don't want over-exuberant deregulation, but you don't want excessive re-regulation, which is what we have now in Indonesia. And my time is just about up. That's good, because I think we're on last slide. And so we want appropriate prudential metrics to measure effective risk mitigation. The other major recommendation is to try to mainstream microfinance into a national strategy for financial inclusion. That is, rather than thinking of microfinance as a special topic by itself, to try to demarginalize it and integrate it into a general development strategy as part of a national poverty alleviation strategy for more sustainable, more inclusive, more equitable growth. This is really the last slide because it's references. The timekeeper, she's very strict. If you want to know more about why I say you have regulatory failure and backsliding in Indonesia, there's a reference here to a paper I co-authored with Professor Prasetya Tantoko at Ahmad Jaya University. If the banks are doing so well, why can't I get a loan? Kind of a dilemma in Indonesia. Want to know more about financial inclusion and financial inclusion development policy in Indonesia? Bank Indonesia has a very nice survey with a lot of the data that supports the conclusion that Indonesia is underbanked. And if you want to compare Indonesia with other countries around the world, the World Bank has a Global Financial Inclusion Index, Global Findex, which is updated every year. And all of these can be found at the sites listed. We'll post this for free. The APER, if you go there, you might have to subscribe, but Harvard has a kind of an open system called Dash, where you can also have access to it. And with that, I am really out of time, yes? Thank you.
Thank you, Jay. The last of the last. Everybody's ready for drinks and dinner and so forth, right? Does everybody have a copy of the paper? Okay. This is a different format than everybody else used today, and a different format than I myself use most of the time. This started as an outline, you know, that I was just not even a PowerPoint, but just an outline. Like Dawn Emerson's presentation, that I would present from. And then as I got developing it, it got longer and longer and more detailed, and I thought, this is pretty dense. I still don't want to put it on PowerPoint. It's still not a full paper ready to send to a journal, but I think it is okay for presentation. But when I present it, I had better have copies of it in front of everybody, because the arguments, the evidence, and so forth in here is pretty dense. So hopefully the overall outline and so forth is clear, but I think it will help everybody to follow along. And another thing is, I don't know how long this is going to take. I'm very used to elaborating on stuff, you know. That first page, I could talk for an hour, I'm sure, about that first page. So I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to, because I would then have to stop way before my time. So. I'm not going to do that, but I'm actually going to read this, and so you have it in front of you as well, and not elaborate on it, and hopefully in the Q&A we will have a chance for elaboration. I want to say two more things prompted by today's discussion so far. The first is that Tom Popinski, this morning we should have coordinated, we didn't need to coordinate because we had a kind of automatic coordination here. He talked about structure and agency. Structure as constraints and agency as the operation of individual actors within that. And he talked about the importance of that in the Indonesian case because there are so many constraints that are in conflict with each other and so forth. That's the direction. So you could say that what Tom said about structure and agency, all of my paper is a commentary on that, or is a provision of some specific cases within that framework. So that's the first thing that I want to say in response to the discussion so far. The second thing that I want to say is that I'm very unhappy to report that Dede Basri has a different opinion from me. And he's an economist, and I'm only a political scientist, and the subject is something that he knows something about, and I obviously know less about it. The argument that I'm making here is that the decision to reduce the subsidy was a success for Jokowi. And Dede started out this morning by saying, actually, it's been reversed already. And I start thinking, really? Where can I find this? So we had a little conversation about it, but it was an economics-heavy conversation. And I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that now. And in fact, I will skip over that, and I just ask you to kind of bear with me. I'm presenting two cases here in terms of Jokowi's policies, and one of them is the reduction of the fuel oil subsidy, which I am calling a success. And we can later on have a discussion about whether it was a success, whether it's been reversed, and so forth. Okay, the title is, What Difference Do Presidents Make and Why? The short answer, in my view, watching Indonesian politics for so many decades, is, and that starts with Suharto, starts with Wijoyo, as people who make a difference, a real difference for the future of the society. See, I'm elaborating already. I'm going to read this. They can make a big difference. Presidents can make a big difference, as we see in the impact on society of contrasting decisions by former President Yudhoyono and current President Jokowi on major issues confronting the country. One about the economy, the other about KPK, Indonesia's anti-corruption commission. On the economy, Jokowi succeeded in reforming the fuel oil subsidy policy in his first months in office, while SBY failed to do so in 10 years. On the KPK, Jokowi has put its authority and future in jeopardy, while SBY gave its support in critical moments that allowed it to play a significant corruption-fighting role for 10 years. So where I start this paper is with the idea, what I really want to do here is to analyze Indonesian democratic presidents, the policies that they had, the reasons for them, how we can call them successes and failures, and so forth. And so I start out with this little clear-cut conception in my mind that SBY failed in this one area and succeeded in the other, and Jokowi just did the opposite. But what I'm actually going to talk about in this presentation is just Jokowi, because if I tried to do the SBY part too, it would obviously be too long, but that's maybe for the final paper. Okay, what explains these differences? And this is where what the whole paper is organized in terms of. I think it is conscious choices. This is coming after a lot of consideration of how politics works and what the importance of various aspects of it. I think it's conscious choices on the part of the two presidents, which can be examined in terms of, first, their goals as presidents, including the presidents or absence of political will. That's a much maligned concept, but I think we can see very clearly how that is working in this present situation. In one case, Jokowi had political will, and in another case, he didn't or doesn't yet. And when we look at SBY, he never had political will. And it makes a difference. We can make these comparisons and say, okay, there are some outcomes that come from that. So goals as president, including the presence or absence of political will, existing political resources and constraints, roughly what Machiavelli meant by fortuna, and strategic and tactical decisions, roughly what Machiavelli meant by virtù. And so the framework, the overall framework that I'm using here really derives from Machiavelli's initial framework. Political scientists in the 20th and 21st century have made conceptual improvements to that framework. But that is still a brilliant foundation for understanding how politics operates. Okay, this means that, and this is also important, it seems to me, as in any democracy, these presidents can be held accountable for their choices in the short run by the electorate and in the long run by history. It also means that we, as observers and or players, including voters, have tools to assess their achievements. This seems simple, straightforward. Machiavelli gave advice to princes, and that was a good model, and its usefulness today seems simple and straightforward, but most political scientists don't look at things in that way. Most political scientists are much more interested in building theory and in giving more weight to the power of political forces in society, whether interest groups or institutions or markets or whatever. So what I'm trying to do here is to focus on how we can assign responsibility, how we can decide that individual presidents are or are not responsible. Most political scientists do not approach the problem in this way, but one who did, and I do want to give this guy credit, was Richard Neustadt. As it happens, one of the founders of the Harvard Kennedy School, and the author of Presidential Power, The Power to Persuade, published in 1960. And here's a memory of my own, I guess it's graduate school days, a picture of John F. Kennedy between his election and his inauguration, walking around carrying a copy of Presidential Power. You think political scientists, you know, what a model that is for political scientists and what have influence in the world. Maybe that's my imagination, you know, maybe it didn't actually happen. But I had this picture very clearly in my head of seeing that in a newspaper. What Neustadt did was to study three American presidents, Roosevelt, Truman, and Eisenhower, and he argued that five factors determine the success or failure of a presidential program. The president must be fully involved in the process of decision making. His words must be unambiguous. His view must be publicized widely. The instruments and resources available for implementation must be up to the task, that's administration and so forth, after the decision. And the recipients of his instructions must accept his authority and legitimacy in terms of that particular policy or program. Now, I could spend the whole paper kind of showing you point by point how Jokowi was fully engaged on the subsidy issue, but totally unengaged on the KPK issue, and so forth. You know, I can go down with each of those, but I don't want to do that here because I want to look at the causes of it. This is, in political science terms, this is the deep-ended variable that I'm trying to explain, and I want to spend most of my time talking about the independent variable instead. But every Indonesian in the room, you should all be smiling, right? Oh yeah, Jokowi, on the subsidy issue, he was fully engaged in all of this, but on the KPK, what a mess. So everybody has a sense that this is correct, but again, we can come back to that later on. Okay, so this is a very stark contrast. What explains the very stark contrast? All right, well, in terms of the fuel oil subsidies, which I call a success, and here I'm quoting the obviously out-of-date bulletin of Indonesian Economic Studies, most recent issue, which said that there was substantial reform by cutting the fuel oil subsidies. It's an important step towards a market-based mechanism. Subsidies for premium gasoline were removed. The price is now adjusted each month depending upon the price of crude oil, and so forth. But there are caveats that are in the literature generally, and this is important also to recognize that just because he has made a major policy advance, it doesn't mean that this can't be reversed. And then one reads everywhere in the literature that it is possible to reverse this. And as Denny was arguing this morning, maybe he's already reversed it, or at any rate, that's a discussion that we have to have later on. Okay, so how do we explain this? I said I wanted to talk about three aspects of this. One, goals, including political will. And second, resources, and third, resources and constraints. And then finally, strategy and tactics. Well, on this issue, I think that Jokowi pretty clearly showed political will from the beginning. He also had a specific commitment to an understanding of economic reform. He was interviewed in Tempo, for example, and this is my translation. What are your economic goals? He said, from consumption to production, from consumption to investment, from consumption to industry. And you can hear how that's echoed. That's the market argument that has been made by several people today. So Jokowi seems to be fully on board with an understanding of how modern economies operate and how he wants to be a part of that. His recent trip to the United States, as I observed it anyway, seemed to confirm that. Also, when he went to China shortly after he was inaugurated, when he went to Australia after that, and when just recently when the Australian Prime Minister came to Jakarta, all the talk is about how we want to get the growth trajectory as high as possible, as soon as possible, and we understand what we have to do in terms of our interaction with the global economy to do that. And so I see here a commitment to economic reform, at least that verbal one, but also an understanding of how the modern economy operates. Now, the political resources that he brought to bear to this are, as I guess I already said that in terms of goals, his political resources are first an understanding of how modern economies work. It goes back to Suharto and his professional economists, led by Wijoyo and Sastro. Again, this is an echo of an argument that's been made several times today. Wijoyo is given more credit than Suharto, I think, as I was listening to most of those arguments this morning. But it's really the team of Suharto and Wijoyo. Suharto understanding that he could rule a lot more benevolently if the economy grew, and Wijoyo promising him how to do that. And they formed a partnership that lasted for quite a long time. But that understanding has then been adopted by every president since, except for Gus Dur. Abdurrahman Wahid, didn't really understand how modern economies operate. But even Megawati did, and certainly Jokowi does. Second, there are functioning, and this is also something that was brought up in terms of how do you get improvements. David Cole earlier said that the Ford Foundation came in and financed the development of professional economists and so forth in the 1950s, and that laid a foundation for the policies of later on. So functioning government ministries and personnel in this area, the most recent Minister of Finance maybe doesn't agree that his ministry is as good as all that, but it's a lot better than most other ministries in the country. I think everybody would agree. A third political resource is no fear of mass protest. Here again, I'm thinking about SBY. SBY's principal motivation as president seemed to be to avoid mass protest. Whenever he kind of calculated that there might be mass protest on an issue, he backed off. And we can see Jokowi, first as mayor of Solo, and then as governor of Jakarta, he didn't back off mass protest. When there were strikes for raising wages and so forth, he said, no, we're not ready to do it. So Jokowi was ready to take actions as a politician. And I never did see that from SBY. Okay, constraints. This has also been talked about quite a lot so far today. There's a strong cultural constraint, which is a pervasive anti-market ideology throughout the society. Jokowi's own populist rhetoric during the campaign seemed to give impetus to that, could be interpreted as anti-market. There's a political constraint against the fuel oil subsidies, against market economics, especially strong in his own party, PDIP, led by Megawati, daughter of the greatest anti-capitalist, anti-imperialist in recent history. And also, of course, and this was SBY's problem, every time he tried to talk about fuel oil prices, middle class people, owners of motorbikes and so forth, would protest, and they would say this was against the people and so forth. So these are pretty powerful political constraints. But Jokowi saw a window of opportunity at the beginning of his administration because the threat of rising oil prices was so great that it could overwhelm the state budget, including, of course, his own main initiatives. He promised in his campaign to develop infrastructure and so forth. He needs money to do that. Where's the money going to come from? It has to come from reducing the fuel oil subsidies. Window of opportunity is a term that's thrown around quite a lot, but it was developed very nicely as a political science concept by John Kingdon in his book, Agendas, Alternatives, and Public Policies. What he meant by the very specific meaning to it is the moment when recognition of a policy problem, so the rising costs of the budget, the generation of policy proposals, there had been policy proposals generated for quite some time about how to deal with this, and political events, the political event being the election of Jokowi, meet. And so Kingdon has a really beautiful conceptual framework, mostly used for a study of the Carter administration and its policies. But this is a generally applicable framework that can be used for the analysis of policy making. Also, Harvard's Merrily Grindle and John Thomas developed a very similar concept, but they used crisis as their rather than window of opportunity. Crisis is the driver. I think crisis is too broad a term, too abstract a term. I like window of opportunity and mechanisms for using that window of opportunity better. But there's a literature about this, and I also can't help but bring up Mohammed Sadli, got referred to a couple of times this morning. His even picture on the wall, he was a wonderful person, a friend. And we used to joke about Sadli's law, which is just another version of the same thing. When times are bad, when there are tough choices to be made, then you're more likely to get good policy out of it. So this is all of a picture. The way in which that I want to present this is in terms of Kingdon's window of opportunity and how one works within that. He also made effective use of a policy entrepreneur. Jokowi did, State Enterprises Minister Rini Sumarno. Many accounts show that she took the lead role in convincing other people that the fuel subsidy had to be reduced, and she's been playing a similar role since then. Okay, so those are the most important things. All right, so my conclusion is that this was a success, but there are a lot of caveats, and presumably we're going to be talking about them some more. It could be still undone. And maybe the most important caveat that I've been thinking about is the money that is being used here for infrastructure development is really going through state industries, BUMN. And the state industries are notoriously inefficient and corrupt. So it doesn't look very promising for me to take this money that you save from the fuel oil subsidies and plow it into state enterprises in which you will have a heck of a lot of corruption and ordinary protectionism and so forth. Okay, that's the fuel subsidies. On the KPK, the Corruption Eradication Commission, this has been a policy
failure. And I think the reasons for it is that it was a lower priority goal for Jokowi. Also, he had less political will. But he also made strategic and tactical mistakes. It's not so much, some people argue that it's weak resources or powerful constraints. A powerful constraint being Megawati's opposition, or all the members of parliament from the PDIP being in opposition. And we have to weigh those things, and maybe we can talk about those also in the Q&A. But anyway, to my mind, it was that Jokowi himself made it a lower priority goal, he had less political will, and he made these mistakes. His goals, the problem of low and unclear priority. In the Nawachita, which is Jokowi's campaign platform, there's an unambiguous commitment. It took me a while to find this. We will prioritize, by translation, we will prioritize eradicating corruption in a consistent and believable way by strengthening the KPK. That's a serious commitment, obviously, but it's only one small point in a very large platform. So he had many other things, many other fish to fry as well. But after the election, Jokowi was more promising. He did an extraordinary thing. He did an extraordinary thing. He did an extraordinary thing after the election, which was to get all of his cabinet ministers to be vetted by the KPK. That was something totally unexpected. All right, let me just read through my conclusions. First, the role of counterfactuals are a problem in this type of analysis, because it's easy enough to put evidence together that says that the subsidy, here is the way in which Jokowi made the fuel oil subsidy policy. But to say that he didn't do something is much harder to write an argument about. Nevertheless, I want to fault Jokowi for not acting to strengthen or maintain the KPK because of its importance as an issue, his campaign promise, and sufficient political resources. On the other hand, it's also true that Jokowi has demonstrated political will in the case of the subsidy issue. He's also demonstrated strategic and tactical skill. He is capable of operating as a real president, able to see a window of opportunity and so forth. We also see the effect of the constraints, especially his lack of control of his own party and of parliament. But an important takeaway here is that he now has a new political resource, which is battle experience. He's a year in office. He also has his own key player and possibly political entrepreneur in terms of the KPK issue in the person of Luhut Panjaitan, whom I talk about in that, if you just look up at the substantive argument that I'm making about KPK. He did use Luhut Panjaitan, his minister, coordinating minister for defense and security. He did use him to try to resolve his issues with the police, and so he might do that again. So we have a mixed case here. Jokowi succeeded in one area, failed in another, but we can also talk about the political resources, the pattern of political resources and constraints, and how he might develop a better strategy for the remaining 4 years of his term. Thank you.
Thank you. So, questions? Please continue to identify yourselves.
Hi, my name is Christian. I'm from the Harvard School of Public Health Center for Health Decision Science. I have two questions for Professor Van Alken. On your presentation earlier, when I see that the poor have to apply themselves to the programs, my initial thoughts is that if they have to go through a day long of dissemination sessions and then have to incur transport costs to the place for application and then waiting for hours, there's a lot of this upfront economic cost, and a lot of the people who are poor, they cannot even afford to lose a day of working as tukang beca or tukang baso. So how do you observe that in your research, and is this something that's you see? And then the second one, in terms of enrollment, there's a lot of this recurring cost, and you mentioned earlier that BEPES surveys and all of this data collection is, sure, it's expensive, but it's incurred by the central government. The Minister of Finance may not be happy for it, but it's from the government's perspective. While when you are using the community approach, there might be cheaper for the government, but the community themselves, there are time involved, there are transporting involved, there are foregone income that involved with that. Do you have some kind of economic analysis to see which one of the two is more efficient, and what is the distributive justice of that? Thank you.
Great. So these are outstanding questions. So the first is on the self-selection cost for the poor. Absolutely, this was a real concern, right? So in fact, one of the reasons that we didn't know if this was going to work, and we go through this in much more detail in the paper, is we heard exactly what you said, which is, you know, if you make, you know, the it's easy for sort of a middle class person to go and take a day off work, but for a really poor person, like, it's one day of them missing work, one day they can't eat, they're not going to be able to do it. And maybe that's a reason it wouldn't work well. So I guess I have two responses. The first is, on balance, we didn't know kind of, when we certainly heard that response from people, but we didn't know kind of on balance how to weigh that off until we did the research. And the answer is, while that might be something that we hear, and certainly there were some people for whom that was very important, on balance, people made it work, and the government was able to find a much poorer selection of people and kind of much more deserving selection of people when it used that approach. So on balance, that doesn't end up being the biggest issue. Part of that is, this is a very valuable program, right? So if you get PKHA, you get about 1.2 million rupiah a year for 6 years. So it might be worth missing, you know, half a day of work to go do that. But the second point, another point though, is that we also take very seriously, I mean, I think your comments are really outstanding, and is something that's missed a lot in the policy debate, is we say, oh, have a community meeting, and people forget about the costs that are imposed by the people who have to show up at this meeting for hours. And I completely agree with you that policy analysis absolutely needs to include those time costs. And we do. And so if you actually go and look at our papers, we actually think through kind of what are the different, we lay out in the papers kind of the costs and benefits of these programs, and we absolutely take into account kind of time costs and you know, put a valuation on those and say, here is the cost paid by X, Y, and Z, and then, you know, it's up to the government to decide how do they trade those things off? But you're absolutely right that the time costs need to be included, and we take that very seriously.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Ben Wilson. I'm managing editor of the Bulletin of Indonesian Economic Studies. I just wanted to indulge in some shameless self-promotion in response to Professor Little's presentation. I just wanted to say that there's more information. So you cited the April issue here. There's more information on the fuel subsidy in the August issue and also in the December issue, which will be out shortly.
You can't blame me for the December issue. But I thought I read the August issue and I didn't see any reversal of the program there.
And Ben also provided brochures about BIES. They're long gone, but there's a lot of information online as well.
Thanks.
I would like to comment on your presentation, Bill. I think this is excellent. But I think the real challenge for Jokowi, if we want to see him whether he was successful or not, for, you know, removing the fuel subsidy. The first question is why he was considered successful or removing the fuel subsidy. The answer was because the oil price at the time collapsed. So that's the reason why there was no demonstration against the government. So the real challenge is we have to see when the oil price back to the normal situation, and two possibilities, whether the international oil price goes up or the exchange rate depreciate. And you know what happened? The average for the oil price now is about $55. The government assumption is $60. But the exchange rate depreciated by almost 20%. So the domestic price should increase higher than the decline of the oil price. Mm-hmm. So that is why the one who bear the burden now is Pertamina. And Pertamina is 100% owned by the government, which is become a contingent liabilities. That's the first issue. So we cannot tell until this happened. Second one, let me share with you. A few hours before the government adjusted the fuel price, I had a conversation with the current Minister of Finance. And I said that you just make sure that you let the price move to the market freely. Because once you give a chance to the government to announce it every 3 months, and it won't go to happen. But if you let the price to move freely, it won't give a chance for anyone to protest, because the price just, you know, just move every day. What we call the menu cost.
Right. But isn't that problem solved when you change the fixed subsidy, whatever the... You just have an additional subsidy. Instead of guaranteeing a fixed price, you just have a fixed subsidy, so 1,000 rupiah that you add. Doesn't that solve that problem? Because then the consumer starts to get used to the idea. I mean, the price is still not the market, international market price, because there is a subsidy of 1,000 rupiah, but that is still a lot less of a burden on the government budget.
It solved the problem, but the problem is the government announced it every 3 months or 6 months. Mm. So Jokowi concerned, every time he raised the price, other prices increase, but when he announced it to lower the price, none of price, you know, decrease. It's sticky price. Right. So if you want to consider this, you have to let the price to move freely. And it didn't happen. So for that reason why, now the government, next year, they have to pay probably about $1.5 billion for Pertamina, unless... I cannot comment on the financial balance sheet of Pertamina.
Thanks. In the corner up there, please.
Hello, my name is Latifa Al-Ansari. I'm a grad student in UMass Boston for conflict resolution. I have a question for Professor Liddell about the political resource, especially in the number 3, that no fear of mass protest, that you were saying that in the times of Joko Widodo right now, our president, he has no fear of mass protest, while in the terms of SBY, he had fine sense of what could cause mass protest and avoided all of that. So in my point of view, the mass protest has been on since 98 in Indonesia, and the current mass wave in Indonesia currently based on the currently in the Jokowi term, it follows the campaign that he had in 2014, that he has a lot of mass, and it is, I think, the antithesis of the SBY time, that when he avoided all of the mass protests for 10 years, as you mentioned. So based on what you said in here, the period of Jokowi, is that mean that it is prone to conflict, because people are like, okay, I don't mind to go to the street, it's okay. The character of Jokowi, he is open to public, and public don't mind to go to the big to the central of Jakarta to do the protest. So is that mean? And then this is already putting the assumption of the political, economy, and security condition in Indonesia right now. Do you think Indonesia is prone to conflict on this period of Jokowi only? And then, of course, in terms of talking about conflict and avoidance of it, we have to include the involvement of intelligence body of Indonesia, right? But and then the second question of that is, what do you think about it? Is that mean that if back then the intelligence has succeeded in helping the president SBY to avoid the conflict, is that mean that right now if there are more protests in the street, the intelligence did not work, or actually the intelligence are adopting the character of the president as the public adopting the character of the president too? Thank you.
I'm not entirely sure that I understand the question, but let me start this way. Starting in 1996 or so, there was a great increase in mass demonstrations and public protests and so forth that peaked shortly after the overthrow of Suharto. And I don't, there's very good World Bank data on this. Who is the author, Indonesian author, starts with a Z, Zainuddin, somebody? Anyway, there is very good data that shows the rise in protest, the fall of Suharto, a lot of turmoil in the first year of Reformasi. But after that, the level of protest goes down to a pretty low level. And this has been challenged by some scholars. Ashutosh Varshney, for example, has tried to look at data from local level newspapers and so forth to see if that might have failed to state a lot of the protest that was still going on. And I don't think that he found anything significant. And so we have a finding here. The protest went up and then down. And so since democratization, since, I don't know, 2002 or so, the level of protest has been pretty much the same from year to year. So I'm not talking about anything extraordinary of the sort that brought down the New Order and brought down Suharto. I'm just talking about the ordinary way in a democracy in which people organize to make demands. And in Jokowi's case, what I'm remembering and what I talk about here, what I'm remembering is that when Jokowi became governor of Jakarta, there were mass protest, labor union organizations and protests to try to get the minimum wage. That's, I think this is, right, somebody else can correct. I think this is the regional minimum wage for Jakarta to get it raised. And Jokowi said he wasn't going to do that. He stood up to the protesters. And I remember thinking at the time, observing that behavior, that this is a man with some political courage. And I contrast that with President Yudhoyono, who, whenever he would get wind of such a thing, you know, protest on any kind of issue, he would back off. And I thought, I saw that particularly in terms of the fuel oil subsidy. You know, that he had a sense, he understood that in other countries too, governments can be brought down by mass demonstrations over costs of fuel oil. And so he always kind of backed away from that. It's more complicated story than that, and he actually tried at the beginning of his first term and so forth to deal with the problem, and he had some good advice at the time. Dede Basri was himself, I think, involved in trying to give advice to him at that time. But anyway, in the long run, he decided not to. And I think what I see there is the main variable operating, is his reluctance to respond to force in that way. Now, a lot of your question was about intelligence, meaning spies, I guess. I don't think, of course, in the overthrow of Suharto, there were there were generals who organized on behalf of one side or another, and there was a good deal of made-up demonstrations, rent a crowd, and things of that kind. But I don't think that we see much of that in the most recent period. And I don't think that SBY was using the intelligence authorities either to keep down protest or to foment protest. That's not a part of the way in which he governed. And Jokowi, even less so. I mean, he's just a kind of a straightforward democratic politician. So you shouldn't see these people as conspirators, I guess is my second answer.
Thank you. Ben apologizes, he had to leave us another commitment, and I believe we're pretty much out of time.
Sorry about that.
It's complicated questions. Great questions, great engagement. I will not speak for 15 minutes, just a couple of minutes of closing comments. And I would just like to say, what a delight this action-packed, fun-filled day has been. It's the first time that we actually had to close our invitation portal for a Southeast Asian event. The response was so overwhelming, we just stopped taking RSVPs. We apologize to you backbenchers there who were not able to find a vacant seat. It's a great problem for us to have, but at least I think we were able to feed everybody, so a little balance here. And I think we've achieved our primary objective in a spectacular manner, namely to increase awareness of Indonesia in the United States as a first step in promoting constructive engagement and productive collaboration between Americans and Indonesians. And hence entitled this conference, despite some protests, Understanding Indonesia, Revealing the Mysteries of Asia as an Inscrutable Giant. Even though, yeah, those who know Indonesia, maybe the country is not at all mysterious and somewhat predictable, this conference has been convened so that experts, like the dissenting panelists, could share their insights with a much broader audience, comprised of those with a more general interest and perhaps less specific knowledge of Indonesia. And actually, the title was conceived partly just to help get people interested, figure out what this is all about, but it's also in reference to something that the current U.S. ambassador to Indonesia, Ambassador Robert Blake, says quite often. He says, Indonesia is the biggest country Americans never heard of. So that was kind of a reference to that. And he's a great enthusiast, and he goes all over the country, but he gets frustrated because there's not a lot of recognition or knowledge about Indonesia in the U.S. And we believe it's in the interest of both countries to learn more about each other. Just, you know, some of the statistics that many of you know, Indonesia, fourth most populous country, third largest democracy, largest Muslim majority country, 16th largest economy in the world, a member of the G20, strategically located on some of the world's most heavily traveled sea lanes, a country with considerable unrealized potential, and it's also very similar to the United States in its embrace of diversity and tolerance. So the U.S. national model, I pluribus unum, out of many, one. If you look at Indonesia, Bhinneka Tunggal Ika, unity and diversity. It's the same thing, it's just the reverse order. And as Professor Seish noted in his opening remarks, this conference is part of a larger effort at the Harvard Kennedy School to develop capacity throughout Harvard University to both undertake rigorous scholarship about Southeast Asia, including joint research with Southeast Asian scholars, and that gets again to the point about who, where, maybe place is not so important, and to collaborate with Southeast Asian leaders in the formulation and implementation of better public policies. So since the launch of our Harvard Kennedy School Indonesia program in 2010, we've had many Indonesians come to the Harvard Kennedy School's degree students, non-degree research fellows, participants in our open enrollment global executive education programs, and we've had many HKS faculty and students pursue applied policy research together with Indonesian colleagues. And moving beyond HKS, we've worked very closely with the Harvard University Asia Center. It's a university-wide institute to develop Southeast Asia studies more broadly at Harvard. For example, we have now created a permanent Thai studies program. And this includes an endowed professor of Thai studies at the Faculty of Arts and Science, a permanent Thai language program, also at FAS, and an ongoing Thai current events program that spans the entire university. Harvard has also established an endowed Prince Awalid bin Talal Professor of Contemporary Islamic Religion and Society in Southeast Asia at the Harvard Divinity School, and the Jeffrey Chia Professor of Southeast Asian Studies at the Harvard Kennedy School. And we now have an Indonesian language program for credit at FAS, as well as an Indonesian language program not for credit at the Harvard Kennedy School. So although Southeast Asian studies in some ways might be considered facing a lot of challenges in the United States, we hope that the Southeast Asian specialist is not an endangered species, however we define it. Maybe the key is to redefine it, yeah? And we hope the conference will be a regular event, maybe annual or biannual, and we invite you to become continued partners in our initiative. But alas, all good things must come to an end. So please join me in thanking our co-sponsor for this conference, the Harvard University Asia Center, especially the Asia Center Director, Professor Arthur Kleiman, and the Asia Center Executive Director, Elizabeth Liao. Although both are China specialists, They have nevertheless provided unwavering support for the development of Southeast Asia studies at Harvard. It's a little bit like you need a Nixon to go to China. You kind of need a China specialist who doesn't have to prove they believe in China to develop a non-China-centered program. So thanks for you. I'd like to thank the Australian National University, ANU's Indonesia Project, for its support, and especially to my two co-conspirators from the Land Down Under who helped dream up this event with me, couldn't join us today, Professor Hal Hill, who is one of the world's leading experts on Southeast Asia, and Professor Budi Raisosudarmo, who is the head of the ANU Indonesia Project. And a former, I have to say, senior research fellow at our HKS Indonesia program. ANU has really done an incredible job in encouraging Indonesia scholars and in promoting Indonesia scholarship. For example, I'll give you a plug there, Ben, one of ANU's flagship products is a leading academic journal in Indonesian economics, the Bulletin of Indonesian Economic Studies, BIES. And Ben Wilson, as you've heard, managing director, has joined us for this event. So another note about ANU, the ANU Indonesia Project, if I'm not mistaken, just celebrated its 50th anniversary this year, which to us is a remarkable accomplishment since we're just concluding our sixth versus 50. So thanks to ANU. I'd also like to thank all of our esteemed speakers for being so generous with their time and knowledge. It's really a rare assemblage of such talented and respected Indonesia scholars, and we're eternally grateful for their contributions to our conference. So thank you very much. And let's not forget the wonderful HKS team that worked so hard to make this happen, led by our HKS Indonesia Program Coordinator, Trisyawati Bansachu, assisted by our Fulbright language teaching assistant. I said we have a not-for-credit language program. That's because of the Fulbright language teaching assistant, Sri Rejeki, who is also an incredibly strict timekeeper. Thank you. Our tireless HKS student volunteers. We have Amri Ilma, who merangkap juru kamera. A partner in crime. We have, Belfa de Fara. Thank you very much. And our equally tireless BPS statistician turned HKS volunteer, Afi Nofi Astuti, are you? There you go. Thank you very much. And last but not least, please give yourselves a hearty round of applause for being such engaged participants in this noble endeavor. Akhirnya. Akhirnya, benar. Kami dari AKS. Mohon maaf kalau ada kurang berlangsungnya potensi ini. Selamat ulang dan sampai jumpa lagi.